In the winter air, beneath the sky, hidden away on mountains high, or buried deep and out of sight, nestled where there is no light. If it knows your face, your name, it will hunt you just the same. Try to scream or try to fight, just do not sleep. It comes at night. Welcome to Monster of the Week, the show where we find old monsters from editions past and retrieve them for use in your 5th edition D&D game. Today we are talking about none other than the Retriever, and I'm not talking about the fluffy kind that gets your newspaper for you, more the demonic construct kind from the Nine Hells that gets your escaped prisoners for you. These eight-legged freaks have been in every edition of D&D since the beginning, aside from 5th of course, and as such they have been through many different designs and interpretations of what exactly they are. In old school D&D, the Retriever is typed straight up as a demon. Although it is made of mostly metal, it is sentient and is natural, so to speak. In 3.5, the Retriever is considered a construct, although it's listed under the section with all the other demons. The lore implies that it's technically a construct, but it's created by the demon lords to serve their purposes, so it ends up in this kind of weird gray area between the two. This is personally my favorite interpretation of this creature, since it can basically be roleplayed as a demon or a construct, and those are both creature types that we don't have a lot of in 5th edition. In 4th edition, the Retriever is actually an elemental with the construct subtype, and they changed up the lore a whole bunch. Basically, the idea is that rather than being demonic in origin, it was created by the primordial elemental lords to serve the exact same purpose, but just for elementals instead of demons. I don't know why they decided to make this change. Maybe they felt there were too many demons, because 4th edition does have a whole bunch of demons. But it also has a whole bunch of elementals, so I'm not really sure what the thinking was here too, but it's a different spin on the same kind of idea, which is never a bad thing. The nice thing about these different interpretations is that they're all technically correct. Not that you can ever be incorrect when making a D&D monster, because you're the DM, that's kind of the whole deal. But they're all just examples of ways to spin the same creature. So maybe you have a lot of demons in your game and that's kind of what you're going for, type it as a demon. Maybe you've got a lot of elementals and you still want to use this creature, type it as the elemental construct thing. Ultimately, the flavor of the monster can be changed to fit into whatever setting you want it to, and that isn't true just about the Retriever. You can do that with pretty much any monster, but that's definitely the topic for a different video. To get back on topic here, despite all the crazy different interpretations of this creature, it has always served the same purpose, and that, as the name would suggest, is to retrieve things. It can be a lost item, a lost person, an escaped person, or just anyone that the master of the Retriever wants captured. No matter what or who they are after, the Retriever knows exactly where to find its target and the best way to get there. And it does so, very fast. The only real limitation to this ability is that the one commanding the Retriever has to have touched or at least seen the target at some point. This is a pretty broad stipulation for a creature like this and leaves a lot of wiggle room, and that's why they're so useful, not just as a tool for you as a DM, but also to some creature in the world. Why would you not want to have a Retriever if you were powerful enough to create one or summon one? But before we get into some ways you can use these creatures in your game, let's talk about what the Retriever is actually capable of when doing the retrieving. The core concept mechanically behind these creatures has gone relatively unchanged from edition to edition, and that primarily begins with the fact that they have massive claws and are frighteningly fast. The Retriever is absolutely a melee combatant and will get up close and personal to tear its opponent to shreds. If it happens to be within reach of its target, it will simply claw at them once and use this opportunity to grab its prey. This is how the Retriever will go about collecting its target 90% of the time. But if it happens to be a harder mark, such as an adventurer, it has another trick up its sleeve that it is definitely going to make use of. The Retriever can unleash 4 different rays from its eyes. 3 of them are simply designed to just do damage and take advantage of any vulnerabilities its target might have. It can shoot a ray of fire, lightning, or cold to do this damage, and as frightening as that might be, its 4th ray is what you really want to watch out for. The Retriever's final ray is a ray of petrification. Any target zapped with this ray has to make a save. If it fails its save, it's slowed. At the beginning of its next turn, it makes another save, and if it fails that save too, it is permanently turned to stone. This is the primary means by which the Retriever disables its target and then brings them back to its master. One interesting note about the eye raise here is that in 4th edition, they actually opt to drop the petrification ray in favor of a 4th damage dealing ray of acid. As a DM, if you just don't like using petrification effects, or you just don't feel like it's a good fit for your setting or your adventurers, feel free to drop it and put this acid ray in its place. It's a great substitute. Personally, I feel like the petrification ray fits this creature so well, and it just makes sense that that's something it would have. But again, every game is different, every campaign is different, and every DM is different. So ultimately, just do with that what you will. Now, the final infamous trait of the Retrievers is actually a regenerative ability similar to what Trolls have in 5th edition. The only big difference here is that instead of requiring acid or fire to permanently kill them, like with a troll, they are only susceptible to radiant damage. If you don't have any players in your group that can cast divine magic or cause radiant damage in some way, this is a good opportunity to get them to do some research. Now, if you're using the Retriever in your game, there's a pretty good chance that someone is after one or all of the party members. The first time they encounter the Retrievers, they might be really unprepared, and even if they have someone in the party who can cause radiant damage, they may not figure out that that's what they need to do to permanently kill this thing. If that is the case, when they drop the Retrievers to 0 hit points, instead of having them just spring back to life and combat continues forever, maybe this is a good opportunity to explain that the Retrievers are slowly rebuilding themselves, and after a little while, the party will probably get the hint that this is a good chance for them to get away. Eventually, the Retrievers will catch up to them, but this might take a couple days or even longer depending on what the party does to try and elude them. Just make it as clear as you can to your players that these things are still after them, and hopefully they will use that information to try to find a way to defeat their pursuers. If they manage to find some answers, whether it be from a powerful NPC in your game, classic trip to the library, or anything else, once they figure out what the Retrievers actually are, it could lead to some other interesting questions. Who sent these monsters after us? Why did they send them after us? And most of all, how can we stop their master from catching us? When the party finally does defeat the Retrievers, upon inspecting their bodies, like adventurers are off to do, maybe they find some sort of rune or marking on the Retriever's corpse that gives them a hint or clue as to who is actually after them. It could even be that it has nothing to do with the actual members of the party, but it's simply an item that they found in some dungeon that the Retrievers are after. It's very possible they may have looted something that belongs to a very powerful demon who now wants it back. And if the party is defeated, rather than just having the Retrievers kill them, maybe they just take that item and then leave. If the party gives up, that could be the end of it, but they might track them down and it could lead them into a whole dungeon where they have to reclaim this powerful item that was taken from them. But if the Retrievers are after the party, you have to consider what's going to happen if the party fails and is captured. In a lot of cases, if one or two or maybe all of the party is petrified, it's as good as a death sentence. But that doesn't have to be the case here. Once the Retrievers have brought the party back to whoever their master is, presumably that being is going to have a reason for wanting the party captured. This person, whether it be a powerful wizard, some kind of archfiend, or an evil tyrant, might release them from their petrification and expect something from them. They may merely just be meant to serve as slaves, or perhaps this master is building some sort of slave army. Or maybe this person casts geese or some other sort of curse on the party and forces them to complete some kind of task or quest to win their freedom back. A personal favorite of mine is to have the Retrievers sent out under the command of some powerful demon who is running a gladiatorial arena. He sends the Retrievers out to capture powerful specimens and bring them back to fight in the pit. The players are then given two choices. They can either fight for their survival and eventually their freedom, or they can try to organize a jailbreak with the other prisoners. Either way, there's plenty of room for drama and adventure in a situation like that, and if they do opt to bust out, you know that our eight-legged friends will be hot on their trail. Now, as I mentioned earlier, in 4th edition, these creatures are typed as a straight-up construct. And by that, I don't mean just a being that's been created, but a traditional metal and magic construct, like the Warforged. This interpretation, while not my favorite, can be really useful if you want to bolster the ranks of a construct-heavy or Warforged encounter. They're just interesting monsters, so having one of these things among the ranks of other smaller constructs might be just the thing to make an encounter a bit more memorable, especially if they're being used as mounts. In fact, in the original Fiend Folio, it actually states that demons sometimes use Retrievers as mounts and ride them into battle, so I see no reason why an organized group of constructs wouldn't do the exact same thing. Overall, I find Retrievers to be an exciting monster to go up against, and ever since the time I used them essentially as guard dogs on a Necromancer's Island in my home game, I've kind of had a soft spot for them. In that scenario, there was a necromancer who made his home on a perpetually foggy island, and there were about a dozen of these things crawling all over it at any given time. Whenever intruders ventured onto the island, the retrievers would retrieve them. It ended up working out really well. It was such a fun encounter. There was a great chase scene through the fog. Bard almost got ripped in half. Just a good time all around. I would definitely recommend giving the retriever a try in your home game if you think you've got a spot for it. And if you do decide to go for it, let me know about it in the comments below. If you do like what I do here and you want to see more Monster of the Week or other D&D related videos, please subscribe. I have at least one new video every week. And as always, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it, and I'll see you next time.